In this section, we are going to install the NUT UPS software and test out the solution. The diagram here explains my setup. There is the physical hardware. Installed on it is VMware, on top of which there is Proxmox. And within Proxmox, we have our Windows VM. The physical computer is connected by a UPS. There is a second UPS, an APC, that is connected to the VMware and then made available to Proxmox. What we're going to do is when it goes from online to on battery, we're going to remove the power from the APC. The idea is that this will trigger that it is no longer receiving power, and it will then initiate the process whereby Proxmox will shut down any guests, in this case Windows, and then shut down itself. If we power on this VM, we will see that once it powers up, I am going to go into removable devices. Here is my APC, and I am connecting it to VMware. I've colored the icon red so that I know that this is connected. NUT is a generic utility that manages multitude of UPS devices. Each UPS device has its own settings and quirks, and NUT is designed so that it can operate in a multitude of different environments. In the case shared here, we are working with just one machine attached to a UPS, but NUT can handle situations where there are many UPSs, and it manages to support the running and the shutdown of the operation in different scenarios. If I scroll down to the introduction, here you will see that NUT is made up of a number of components communicating with each other to make the solution happen. One area that is not part of NUT per se is the driver, and that part is the comms between NUT and the UPS itself. Not all UPSs are created equally. My solution, I'm going to use APC, but if your UPS is different and the settings are not working for you, you need to figure out your UPS. One very positive comment is that there is a lot of support in the NUT email group. Let us open Proxmox, and I'm going to shell out. The first thing I would suggest is to check whether there are any updates. If there are, I would update. Next, we're installing NUT. The first thing we need to do is to find the USB, and that is list USB devices. Take note of the bus and the device. So in this case, it is bus 2, device 5. If we do code 5, we can query the device on that USB bus. One utility that comes bundled with NUT is NUT scanner. And this one has scanned the USB bus, and it has given us information about what. We have the driver, and if your UPS is different, this driver can change. We are now going to have to change a few files to set up our solution. I am going to suggest that before you make any changes, you copy the original. I am going to do it just once, but you should do this for every file. Having made a copy, if you need to refer to it, it's there. And now I'm going to edit the file. And as you can see, the file is quite verbose. There is a lot of information here, which you can read. In my case, I am going to delete all the file and replace it with a version I have here. I notice that the bus has changed. This will change for different UPSs. We have the driver, which we had in the NAT scanner. Most of the information here, copied and pasted from there, a description, and some settings that will dictate how NAT behaves. Let me call up Roger's document. The UPS has a state, and the state, for the purposes of power, can be online, receiving power, on battery, which means there is no power, but the battery is providing the power, and low battery, where the UPS is now informing that it is running out of juice. Some UPSs, their state for low battery is transmitted really at the edge, when they probably are now on their last leg. This means that you will not have enough power to safely shut down everything. There are two settings that dictate a low battery state. The first one is the charge, override battery charge low. That means that when, in this case, the battery is under 85%, it triggers a low battery condition. Another setting is the runtime. That states how many seconds are remaining before the battery runs out. And in this case, it is 800. Different UPSs can take a different setting. UPSs that allow you to override their battery charge low, as in the case with my APC, would take this setting. If this fails, then you have a variable whereby you can set it. It doesn't attempt to override this, it just works off its own internal variable. My values are such that I don't have to wait a long time, especially since the APC has no load on it. And so I set values relatively high so that we don't have to wait along before the condition triggers. There is an off delay which is commented. This is the minutes, the time between the shutdown command and the moment the UPS shuts itself off. And there are other settings. The ignore low battery, I've put a comment with a reference to Roger's document. There is another setting, and this is the heartbeat. I have not tested it. If the communication between the UPS and the driver fails, you will get an alert. The next file we are going to edit is this file. Again, I'm going to paste this entry. Here we have a third file. Here we're going to state the IP and port it listens on. Let's save that. Here we're going to define the accounts that can control the UPS. This is the username. That is the password. I'm using the same password. You should use different passwords. What actions this has, it can do set, can do a forced shutdown, and it has admin rights. And it is the primary. If you look up certain documentation, you will see that in earlier versions, the terminology was not primary and secondary, but was master and slave. The next file is related to the heartbeat. It is changing the status of the UPS from online to on battery every 5 minutes. It cycles through every 10 minutes. If there is no change, it's going to trigger that the heartbeat has failed. We will see this in a later file. Here we're going to start the controller and see whether we have all our settings correct. If some setting fails, in earlier testing, for example, I forgot to change the bus, you will get an error that it could not communicate. Here, we are seeing that it's working. We are now going to start configuring what will happen if there is a change of state. We're running as root. We are monitoring PVE1 at localhost. You look here on the side, I'm opening that file. In this file, we're going to run as root. We are going to monitor PVE1, and it is a primary. And here we have the entry related to the heartbeat. The zero parameter is because the heartbeat does not have the power supply. Here we have various settings. I've taken these settings pretty much as they are. This file, we are going to give read-write access only to root. In fact, for many of the files in this particular situation, you can do that safely. Here we have the pointer to the command script, which we will create, and these are log files. Of interest is the event control. So at on battery from heartbeat at localhost, it cancels a timer called heartbeat failure timer. At on battery, same heartbeat, it starts a timer, heartbeat failure timer, with a timeout of 11 minutes, 1 minute more than it was set in the heartbeat. So if this gets to trigger, then the heartbeat has failed. The others relate to the PVE1, and here we have various settings on what should and should not happen if a particular state is triggered. We reference the command file, and here we're going to put a script that tells us what should happen, and that is passed as a parameter. So if we're on that, we're going to send out an email, and we add an entry into logger. Being a script, we need to provide execution rights. We list it. You will see that we have the ability to execute it. This concludes the configuration. Now we're going to
restart,
and we have communication with both the driver itself and with heartbeat. There is a utility, UPSC, that if executed against one of our UPSs, we will get a list of all the variables there are. Different UPSs will return different. One particular interesting value is the state, and this is online. If you want, you can query that parameter by itself to get it in isolation. I'm going to do the same thing with the heartbeat. Sometimes a UPS will allow you to modify its parameters, and UPS read-write will list all those settings you can. The final part is to try this out. The screen is arranged so that we can see everything. And what I'm going to do now, excuse the noise, I'm just going to pull the power of the APC. The APC is
unplugged.
Periodically, we're going to pull this to see what we have. And if you notice, status is on battery. Discharging, battery charge is 100, battery runtime is very big number. If I open email as well, I got my email that it is running on battery. Let me clean up a bit. Shutdown from last time, startup, this event, and the VM has started. Let's go back here and let's query. We are on battery discharging, battery charge still at 100, but battery runtime has gone under the runtime low. So the expectation now is that the process to shut down Proxmox has triggered. And as you can see, I got a message that the battery is low.
And it's starting to power off the system.
VM has shut down, Proxmox has shut down, and if I refresh here, you will see that it's no longer communicating. for the sake of completeness, I am going to restart this virtual machine to confirm whether the host shutdown email got generated. This will ensure that we, if we maximize here, we had the last email, the VM100 has shutdown, host shutdown, so that was generated as well, low battery on UPS.
And finally, the host startup.
If you're trying this at home, you need to always reconnect your UPS. If you found useful, please like, share, and subscribe.